I will do a little bit of reviewing as we go, but in a nutshell, I want to cover something that is a bit more abstract, I think, in concept than the sort of the nuts and bolts of what makes Romanticism. We left our last class talking about the late classicism, which is sort of a continuation of the compositional tradition of Mozart and Haydn, which was then heightened by Beethoven's unique personalized style, which was brought on, of course, by his unfortunate health issues, such as physical pain, as well as being deaf. But in the end, what made Beethoven unique was that at heart he was a romantic who was not able to completely escape the compositional obligations, let's say, of his predecessors. So then you might say, what is Romanticism? Is everyone here familiar with that term? Have you heard the expression being thrown around? Romantic, yeah? Okay, we see three students here, so I know who you guys are, so I know that you guys have heard of it. But are you fully aware of why number one, why it's called romantic, and number two, what is romantic? Not quite, right? So, this is a very complicated topic. I'm gonna try to make it sound as focused as possible, but in a nutshell, Romanticism is the rebellion of classicism. Classicism was all about control, order, form, balance, logical, whereas in Romanticism was the opposite of that. Romanticism focused on, actually, in fact, it tried to do everything possible to dissuade and to sort of fan the fire of skepticism of all the scientific development that was happening in the late 1700s, you know, steam engine, beginning of germ theory, blah, 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 it goes on. And that instead of trying to explain human nature scientifically, people try to explain it from a more emotional and natural place. And I think it's interesting to note that music always goes slower than everybody else. Musicians are always late in jumping on the bandwagon of change. So the ones that were really getting on the change of style, which we call Romanticism, were the writers. There was a man named Johann Wolfgang von Goethe. Does that name sound familiar to anyone? Goethe was a great German writer. I should write his name up here. Who wrote the most famous work of his, or I shouldn't say most famous, but I should say that the biggest project that he did was called Faust. Faust is a play about a man who spent all of his life for studies, and he regrets having lived to his old age, having not tried very much except studying. So then the devil by the name of Mephistopheles comes and says, well, I'm gonna give you a second try, but you have to sell your soul to the devil, to me, and you have to go to hell eventually, but I'll make you young again, and you can do whatever you want. And he said, yes. And he gets young again, and he gets in all kinds of trouble, you know, starts going after women and all sorts of stuff. I'm not going to spoil the story. I encourage you, when the time comes, to read the massive play. It's in three volumes. So, but it was one of the most influential books, and a lot of composers of the Romantic era quoted, including Beethoven, in fact. The elements discussed in Faust. Was that one? Oh, no. Another novel that was really quite loved at the time no, This was written, I think, in 1778, if I remember correctly. He lighted this young Werther, which translates to the sorrow of young Werther. This novel was so popular once it was written that it, how am I going to explain this in the most PG way possible? Well, a little background is, it's somewhat autobiographical story about a young man named Werther who falls in love with a woman who is married already. And they're spending time together, the husband, the woman, and the man in the countryside. And it's written in the form of a letter, Werther's letter to his friend, confessing all of his passions and confusions and upset how this woman is married and there's nothing to be done about it. And so eventually what ends up happening is that the character Werther kills himself. Which is very tragic. The lady is then, you know, forlorn. The man, everyone's confused. It ends in the most tragic way possible. And this novel was so impactful that, in fact, it caused a serious cultural shock to young men in Europe. There was, for example, I mean, this is true, so I must have mentioned it, but many young men committed suicide thinking that they were Werther. They would dress as described in the novel, sort of like the most sick form of cosplay, I suppose. They'd buy guns described as in the novel, and then people would commit suicide. In fact, Beethoven also, when he found out that his hearing was going, this is when he was young, he also contemplated such a thing. And I think it's without, it goes, it probably is not an exaggeration to say that the Werther was probably, this novel was influencing him a little bit. So, I mean, it was crazy. And this was already happening by 1780s, you know. And then came the paintings influenced by that, you know, descriptions of nature, of passions, of love, things of that nature. So that was roughly around 1800s. And let's not forget that this was also the time of French Revolution. I mean, Europe was not in a great place. It was a very confusing time. Many people were being killed. And right after that, of course, was a time of Napoleon going around and invading everybody, causing havoc. I mean, it was a very, very turbulent time. And all of confusion was then reflected in that sense. So that's where we find ourselves with Romanticism in music. So musicians finally catch up to it by 1820s. I mean, music textbooks will tell you that Beethoven's death is the convenient date. 1827 is a convenient date to say that the style completely changed. But I think that's a bit late. Personally, I think that it really started by 1815. But let's find the middle place. I wrote 1820 here. So then the word Romanticism, does that mean that music written during this time was all romantic, as in the sense of passion? No. The word romantic seems that it comes from the word Roman in German, which means novel. So it was a music or style that was novelistic, something that was more involved in passion, yeah? Less biographical. So with that, you know, many personal feelings, internal feelings, individualism is what I wrote, right? Something that was unique to you rather than something, sort of a trope that's been passed down. You're using formula to write music or a story. No, it's more like, you know, something more individual. You're coming from nothing to express your own feelings. That was more important among the Romantics. Focus on nature, the beauty of forest. How many times have you read Lord Byron talking about some tree somewhere in the middle of the forest as he's walking, or a flower? I've already talked about, this is the logic. The individualism eventually, with the influence of Napoleonic War, leads to nationalism. Although today, I don't think I want to focus too much on nationalism. I think that's for the next lecture. I will cover a little bit of it because we're hearing a little Chopin today. mainly Romanticism in music was fueled by the Germans. And let's not forget that Germany at the time was still a scattered, tiny little city-states. But as I said, Napoleon going through the whole land and then them trying to push him out and eventually succeeding, it gave them the feeling that, well, perhaps we should unify and try to not let this happen again. So starting from about 1830s, there was an effort, especially by a nation called Prussia, to try to unify German state. And along with that came paintings and novels and composers. And so that was really the biggest influence for music romantics. And the romantic movements in other countries in Europe at the time were sort of the influence, what kind of influence did German nationalism have on those people? It's really how we should see it. It's not that everybody had some sort of romantic idea. The French particularly was not fond of the Germans influencing themselves, so they have their own little take on it. Too complicated, we're not gonna go too much into that. So I wrote some names here that I personally thought were worth mentioning for German nationalism. There was a man named Karl Maria von Weber, who was about the age of Schubert, so meaning being born around 1790s. And he wrote this opera called Der Freischütz, which is about, it's basically simple. It's too long to try to explain it, but it's basically German mythology. And von Weber's work inspired the well-known operatic composer Richard Wagner, who wrote a whole bunch of things, you know, who doesn't know? Part of his opera called Die Walküre, which is the second one of the Ring of the Nibelung set. And Wagner was particularly a nationalist composer. In fact, Wagner is a very contentious character. And as pianists, this is a piano class after all, we don't very much have Wagner's music. He wrote a piano sonata, but it's not very good and we don't play it anymore. And so Wagner was really an operatic composer. And he was an operatic composer with an agenda to try to put some subliminal messages on the importance of German unification. And anything that threatened it should be expelled. So he was a very outspoken anti-Semite. I remember reading as a student at the Juilliard Library, reading his textbook on conducting. He was a great conductor. And he actually dedicates a chapter on Jewish conductors and why they are bad, which is just an absolute baloney, I have to tell you. And he talks about in his autobiography, which I also read, talking about how much he hated being sharing the same boat with the Jews that were migrating down. And I mean, it's just, he's a horrendous figure. He was wanted in many German states for terrorism. So much so that his father-in-law, Franz Liszt, had to premiere a lot of Wagner's operas for him because he was just an absolute nightmare of a person. He eventually became a parasite to the to Bavarian state. He was able to convince the king of the Bavarian state by the name of Ludwig to basically fund everything. He had a castle given to him and he lived in silk robes and he eventually bankrupted the nation. So he was not a very pleasant man, but he did get his point across and his operas were incredibly popular. And to this day, they are quoted in many forms. The Nazi Germany, of course, absolutely took advantage of that. So when the Nazis marched down the street, they would blast Wagner's music, so on and so forth. So at this point in Israel, Wagner's music is still banned. You cannot play a note of Wagner. but that's for much later, right? This is not part of the Romanticism. It's what eventually ended up happening with this Romanticism. A very sensitive topic. Robert Schumann and Johannes Brahms's name is also mentioned up here because they also had sort of a German agenda, although their take on it was the opposite of Wagner in terms of aesthetics. More on that later in the next class. So this oppressively aggressive nationalism, how did it manifest in other nations? Well, I'd like to go to Poland now because Chopin, our main subject of the day, Chopin was a Polish man of a French descent who lived under a tumultuous time. He left Poland for a grand tour of his career when he was 20 years old. This was 1830. And just as he left, the Russian Empire invaded Poland and annexed it. Sounds rather familiar to this day. And Poland, as a result, suffered a great deal of loss of identity. And there were a whole bunch of literature written by the Polish to try to reestablish their sovereignty, which was of no avail in the 1860s. There was a complete crushing of an uprising. So the Polish would continue to suffer. But because of this, the young Chopin was very heavily shaken by the events of the time. And even though his father was French, his mother was Polish, and he did grow up in Poland in a very, very high society. And so he personally seemed to have been determined to establish Polish nationality among his performances, his compositions, and among his friends and whatnot. And so I think this will be a good opportunity for us now here, Eric, who's playing, can you remind me what you're playing?
Opus 69, number 2.
Okay, great. And which is, what is the title of the piece? So that Yes. Great. And this is a waltz. Okay. So please welcome Eric in playing Waltz in B minor. Thank you. away yet, because have a seat.
That was very nice.
Yeah, because it's a such a beautiful, nicely played. Yes. So, what are your thoughts about Chopin's style? I know that you've worked on this for some time now, so I'm hoping that you have a pretty personalized idea on what Chopin's music means for you. Would you care to share what you think?
I definitely feel it's like very repetitive, those parts, for sure. You know, it has many major, minor. It goes back and forth between those keys.
Yeah.
And the bass, most of all. Like, it's just a nice da-da-da.
Right. So, I have a question for you, okay? Would this piece have been played in a big concert hall, or would it be intended for something else? Do you know?
Probably for something else.
Probably for something else, right? Yeah, because you might notice that the music is very small scale.
Yeah.
Right. So I have to sort of trace back what I was talking about. I talked about how romantics were very individual, right? So it's kind of ironic that we're trying to put it under the umbrella of romanticism when every single person is really very different, right? And Chopin definitely would not have liked to be worked together with his contemporary Robert Schumann. In fact, when Robert Schumann wrote a movement in his set of character pieces called Carnival, called Chopin, and he wrote this in the style of his colleague Chopin, Chopin was furious. It's like, this barbarian writing music that doesn't sound anything like me, and it has no idea what he's doing musically. He got very angry, ungrateful, you'd say. And the reason why I begin that story is because Chopin was sort of a snob. Yeah, as I mentioned, he came from a high society in Poland, and he was considered a prodigy in Poland. So he was kind of arrogant. And so when he left Poland for some public concerts, and public concerts for classical music at the time were kind of like rock concerts. I mean, they went to theaters and people were drinking and they were watching people with magnifying glasses and eating food, people passing out, screaming, throwing flowers at people. I mean, it's like a rock concert. I wish we could go back to that, the classical world. It's too quiet. Anyway, that's my personal opinion. But Chopin hated that. It's like, this is vulgar work. These people don't know what quality is. He hated the public. So he withdrew from public performances right away. And instead, when he eventually settled after roaming around, nationless, you know, his country after all was invaded, so he couldn't really go back home. His passport meant nothing, right? So eventually, settled in Paris, France. I think it was 1832 that he eventually ended up in Paris. He associated himself with the absolute high echelon of the Paris society. And these high echelon society were sort of like a newly made, self-made middle class to upper class that took advantage of the fact that all of the aristocrats were now executed and there was, you know, turn of power. And so now these people who, you know, apparently sought to stop the arrogance and the luxury of the aristocrats did exactly the same thing by throwing very expensive parties, dressing like they were aristocrats themselves. And they threw what's called salon concerts or salon gatherings. And this often would take place in a big living room of a wealthy person, meant for poets, writers, philosophers, painters, musicians, politicians, you know, the high mighty, the absolute invitation only, right, to gather around and share their work. You know, Delacroix, the famous French painter, would show the latest painting. Wow, look at that, discuss what's going on here. And he would talk about, this means that, and that means that, and they'll all be sitting there in fancy clothes. Oh, that's very nice. And then after that, now comes Chopin playing his latest work. And then he would come in and play stuff like this. And then they'd have a political discussion with, you know, over brandy and the cigar and things like that. I mean, it was, you know, pretentious, let's say, simply put. But that was the Chopin's world. So music like that was really meant for that. And I think it's important for us to remember that when you play Chopin, is that it's, except for his concerti, the two pianos, yes.
Is this similar to like the environment where Schubert would perform his pieces?
That's a very good question. So yes, exactly. That was the beginning of the salon. Yes, what Eric is referring to is what we call Schubertiade. These probably started roughly around 1815 and went on until his death in 1828. Schubert also only had, I think, one public concert in his life in 1827, where he made a decent amount of money. He was 30 years old at the time, which allowed him to buy a piano for himself, but then unfortunately died the next year. But yes, Schubertiade was exactly like that. Schubert was so poor that his friends decided to put these small salon concerts over dessert and coffee and wine. So yes, it's the same idea. Very good point. Yes, that's right. Now, so we're talking about what kind of public, what kind of audience members for these salon concerts? Sophisticated or not sophisticated?
Sophisticated.
Very sophisticated. So, would they be in a place where they would understand more about what Chopin was trying to say?
Probably,
right? More abstract things would be definitely felt. So in this music, in this waltz, which was a very popular dance at the time, there are elements in this very specific piece you play that is odd. Waltz is usually for what occasion?
Dancing.
It's supposed to be happy. And yet this music is very melancholic. What is your opinion on why he wrote such melancholic waltz?
Probably because...
That's very hard. I mean, I don't know. I wasn't there. The only person who knows is Chopin. And unfortunately, he's not with us. So we're all guessing here, okay? So
just probably what he wanted to do with the
music. Right. It's something that came from him, right? Whatever turmoil that he was feeling, it's in congruence with the individualist element of Romanticism, right? The struggling artist notion mixed with the nationalist sort of a, you know, orphan, Polish orphan in a way, right? Not that he was an actual orphan, but he felt like an orphan without a country, right? So struggle of that. And also the fact that he was physically very ill. I mean, is everyone aware of what happened to Chopin? He only lived to be 39 years old. He had what's called tuberculosis. Has everybody heard of that? Yes, and back then there was no cure. So if you had tuberculosis, you knew you were going to die. So that's another element of that. Is knowing, you know, sort of the lamenting on how short his life is cut. I think if I remember correctly, this was written in 1845. I might be incorrect on that, I'm guessing that one. But he died only 4 years after, so by that point he probably knew he was dying. Yeah. So, another thing that I wanted to point out, thank you very much, Eric. Now I'm going to take over the piano. I just want to show you, it's just a theory of mine, I can't prove it, but it's a personal theory of mine that perhaps in writing waltzes of that kind, he's sort of mixing in the style of mazurka into his waltz. Now, not bazooka. Some students have said the word bazooka every time I said the word mazurka. Mazurka is a Polish dance. Polish peasant dance that eventually became aristocratic. So here is a mazurka that he wrote, Opus 7, number 1. written right around the time of Russian invasion, actually. Later, 1845. Between the two genres, right? So for me, I can theorize, perhaps he's using the waltz and combining the Polish element to it to try to make a point. So there's the nationalist element there. It's possible. It might have been done subconsciously. We don't know for sure, but it's certainly possible, right? So I can't emphasize enough the importance of doing a little bit of research like that to try to understand what kind of human being this was. So, because especially starting with the Romantics, it's really about individualism. Each person, what are they going through? What's their background and why are they talking about that? Music becomes a lot more intimate as a result. My dear wife, Sarah Rossi, always talks about how it's like looking right into someone's diary. And I think that's what made classical music very uncomfortable for many, because it's very intimate feelings to describe, and some people don't want to hear that. It's like, whoa, too much information. Please refrain from sharing these thoughts and feelings. But those who really love classical music are, I think, are devoted to music because it's so intimate and because it's so weird and possibly borderline pathological. And I would say that in a way, I mean, what are your thoughts? Would you say that Chopin's later works, such as what Eric just played for us, is mentally sound work? Yes.
in the piece that you played, like, just now, like, the latest piece that you just played, he really sounded, like, confused that he didn't really know where this piece was going. He was just, like, composing at this point. It's like when you sit down at the piano and you improvise and you just write down whatever you just played. Like, that's all it was.
Yes.
He didn't really think about this one.
Right. Yes, and...
Okay. Sounded like he was confused.
Mm-hmm. Sounded like he was confused. Yes, and he was a great improviser, so... And often he would change the version that he had. So you'd have many different versions of the same piece because it's always improvising. Yes. Any other thoughts?
I feel in hearing, you had said earlier with the classical period.
Yes.
There was a script and they stuck to it.
Yes.
In this period, they began to throw it out.
Right.
So what is a mazurka? You just, to me,
mm-hmm.
played three versions
right.
of a mazurka.
Right.
So he just tossed the script and
right.
said, this is, to me, this is a mazurka. This is what I want to express
mm-hmm.
in this moment, in this time.
Absolutely.
Same with the waltz. We would expect it to be very a ballroom dancing.
Right.
And he played a waltz. And there are others that are very, they're not that happy, you know, dance
right.
around a room waltz.
Right, exactly. So it became more personalized. So in
yes.
a way, these dance forms are an excuse for a self-expression. Absolutely, right. His earlier waltzes, I mean, I haven't played this in 20 years, so please excuse me. So on and so forth. That one is clearly a ballroom dance. Right.
I think later on it became really grim. I think the him having to leave his country took an effect on
right.
his composing.
Yes. It really, his life really invaded his mindset, and I think that's very important. Another thing too, I think it's worth noting, is that he had a very tumultuous romantic life. One of which was that of the writer named George Sand. Does that name sound familiar to anybody? Yes.
It does. Yeah.
George Sand is a well-known proto-feminist writer. Her name was originally with an S at the end, but she demanded that we change to George, and she demanded it called George, like a man's name. And she was famous for dressed as a man, straying up with a big fat cigar in her mouth. And Chopin and George had sort of a cohabitation. They lived together for several years. Eventually ended a spectacular failure, which was then finalized by George Sand writing a short novel about a character not unlike Chopin, and totally destroying his fame, turning him into some sort of a hypochondriac sick person. So that's probably not very pleasant, you know, and besides his dying. And so I think all of these things, I think, eventually got to him, and like you said, the loss of his nation and living comfortably in France. I also wonder if there's a bit of guilt, because he was very successful in France, you know, finding himself in the middle of the high echelon of Paris society. He was then most well known as a piano teacher of all these people, and he was a great teacher. We still talk about many of the elements that he taught in our lessons today. I mean, I definitely try to implement some of that into my lessons.
You mean survivor's guilt? Like,
yes, sort of that, right.
Like,
yes, many relatives being killed or attacked. And here is living in absolute luxury. And he definitely lived in absolute luxury. He had a chauffeur, he had a carriage. He was famous for his white glove, the leather glove that he wore everywhere he went. I mean, he was vain. He was vain. And You never know. It's a very complicated situation, and one has to ask these questions when learning individual pieces. What was this man going through? And I think individual biographies, of which there are plenty, I think will certainly, if not only will inform you of the piece better, but it's also fun to read, I think. It's really fun to see what's going on. Eventually he succumbed to tuberculosis, and his heart in his will was cut out of his body and was put in a jar and sent to Poland and is buried there. And you can find his heart buried in a cathedral in Poland. And he asked that a handful of Polish dirt be spread onto his coffin, which I think was also done. But this is the heart of Romanticism, an extreme.
Well, I think it's fair to say that he really missed his country.
Right.
Otherwise, he would not have asked.
Exactly.
For such a wish.
Exactly. And that is my feeling, is that in that waltz that you were playing, I think there's a great deal of agony of whatever it was. But for me, that there's an element of that sort of Eastern European exoticism. Mazurka is modes. Well, there's a great one. That's a mode, very strange scale. Called it mazurka, I think.
Mr. Kim, I actually prepared a mazurka to play in this lecture today.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
And is it this one?
No.
Oh, good. Let's hear some mazurka. Oh, yes, of course you did. I'm so sorry about that. Well, it's a pleasure to hear you. Yeah. Yep. Which mazurka are you playing today?
I'm playing the mazurka in A-flat major, I think. Yeah.
Aha, okay.
So the mazurka in Polish was actually called the mazur.
Mazur, yes.
Thank you.
just wanted to like mention something. In the ending of this piece, he wrote "perdendosi," which means dying away.
Yes.
And I slowed down because, like, when he was dying away, right, he was getting slower, and he was also like, it was also getting softer.
Yes. Yes, definitely. Yeah, there are so many terms that one can try to make sense out of. It could mean so many different things. Like perdendosi, I mean, it could mean that. It could mean so many things. Right. So it's really, I think it's important for one to really search for what does it mean for me. If I were the composer, what would that mean for me? I think that question really has to be asked more with the Romantics.
And I had a question that, like, did all these composers die late just because, like, not only did they have a lot of diseases, but was it also because of, like, the curse of the night after Beethoven?
That's a great question, actually. The influence of Beethoven, I should say the shadow of Beethoven was very heavy on them. Yes. Brahms, for example, when he wrote his first symphony, it took him 20 years to complete. Because he said, how can anybody write anything else after the Ninth Symphony of Beethoven? And so he revised and revised and revised and revised. He said it was never good enough, and he eventually just decided to put it out there. And what ended up with was the last movement that sounded very much like Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. So the influence is definitely there. Yeah, I think people are very much aware. Richard Wagner's take on that was that he was the only deserving successor to Beethoven. I mean, he was such a cocky, arrogant man. He said that music of Beethoven, the Ninth Symphony is really important here because it was a symphony that actually added a chorus to it, right? And so Wagner's whole idea there was the notion of Gesamtkunstwerk, which in German means together artwork, meaning everything is added into one. So his operas were not just an entertainment for him, it was for him poetry, music, acting, philosophy, politics. It was everything. And he wanted to create something which engulfed everything and represented everything. And his notion was that, well, Beethoven tried to do that with his Ninth Symphony, with Ode to Joy. You know, the notion of brotherhood and gathering together and living in an Elysian society together and singing and playing. Of course, Wagner did not think to remember that Ode to Joy by Schiller is actually a drinking song about brothers getting together and having a happy time rather than creating a happy society. But of course, Wagner did not. The Romantics did not care for these specifics. They cared for what they wanted to believe in. A lot of warping around, right? I mean, it makes sense that then, of course, something like the rise of Nazi Germany would make sense because there was a lot of hiding of true facts to try to create a story that fit what they believe was right. Right? It's a dangerous thing. I mean, Romanticism really is a very volatile thing. And it created great art, but also it created really devastating outcome for the 20th century. It's something that is always downplayed. Yes, so I wanted to just perhaps end on that German nationalism, which we'll talk a lot about next time. And it's going to be centered around that of the Schumann-Brahms family. Schumann was the one that really thought that his music was that of poetry and novels. And he was particularly in love with the novels of Richter, who loved to write short stories. And these short stories would gather together, seemingly unrelated, would create a one big narrative. And so then he invented a form called character pieces, which we are so familiar with Romanticism, where he would have individual short pieces and all together as a set creates a story. So here I brought a piece called Waldszenen, which was scenes of the forest, which again, focus of nature, where he's talking about that very somber old German forest and then the notions of hunting horns being heard from far away and and that of the beauty of the German rivers and of the trees and whatnot. So I want to play for you the movement called Eintritt, which means the prelude. Another thing I should mention is that from this point on, all of the temple marks are not in Italian. As you know, temple marks are usually in Italian, Allegro, Andante, so on and so forth. But here he writes nicht zu schnell, which means not too fast in German. Which also goes to say something, which is that German music should be written in German. Germanic. Associated with the German forest scenes. And so in that sense, in a subliminal fashion, you're adding the importance of that German culture. See, that's part of that romantic spirit. Okay? More on that next time. Any questions? Thanks very much for joining, and I'll see you next time.